Hello, everyone. Welcome to Nails and Beauty Talk, NFTs, Crypto, and Web3. I am your host, Asia the Bird. I have a very special guest with me today. She's an NFT illustrator. Please welcome Emma Lineham, the creator of LFG Girls NFTs. Hello, Emma, and welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you. It's so great to be here.
Yeah, you're most welcome. I'm glad to have you. So I definitely want to go ahead and get started by asking where you're from and tell us about your upbringing.
Yeah, sure. So I am actually from New Zealand. I was born and bred in New Zealand. I lived there. Hang on a minute. So I was there till about my mid-20s. So yeah, had a great sort of upbringing. I'm from a very small town there. When I lived there, the population was only about 60,000 people. So yeah, quite small. So I thought, okay, it's time to like move on, do some bigger, better things. So I got a one-way ticket to Sydney, where I lived for 5 years. And then from then on, I sort of traveled around for a while. Actually, I went through the States for a while. And then, I ended up in London. I had to get here before the age of 31 so I could get a specific visa to allow me to be here for 2 years. So as I've traveled, my sort of artistic journey has sort of taken off. It's been a whirlwind. I'm 36. So yeah, pretty crazy last 10 years anyway.
Oh, wow. Wow, that's really, really cool. But I definitely want to also talk about, like, how did you get started into art? Did you go to school for it? Were you self-taught?
Recircling back to where I'm from in New Zealand, so it's a small, very small community. However, there's a very big art community there. So art was always massively encouraged, like growing up. I mean, I was always always doing like after school classes and all that. As soon as I picked up pen and paper, like I was just drawing everything. I used to sit there for like hours as a kid, just with like 2 meters of paper. I don't know what you call it in the States. We call it like trace paper. And I was just drawing all these scenes. Like, I mean, they probably weren't the best artworks you've ever seen, but just everything. I was always sort of captivated by what I saw, and it could be any old scene. I would just draw it. And like, honestly, probably from about 7 years old, I did that. And I think just going, as I got interested in fashion, like growing up, I think that's where it sort of changed. My style took on like a new direction. So yeah, I can touch on that in a bit, but yeah, it's sort of.
Yeah, that's really, really cool. But I also want to get into like as well, like, you know, who are like some of like your favorite like fashion designers?
So one of my favorites is like Schiaparelli is probably my all-time favorite. So just really bold, high-end couture pieces, and they just have like no limits in terms of their design, like super just out of the box. That is what I love drawing the most. I also love just like general, more like Balenciaga. Sometimes some of it's super controversial, but I mean, I find it quite interesting. I'm sure you've all seen like the latest stuff that's gone down with them. So yeah, and also Balmain is another one. Just I have a thing for like shoulder pads and like just anything that has like diamonds and like not diamonds, more like sequins and feathers and all that kind of thing, which I know like Balenciaga, just manipulated pieces, like just over the top. That's just completely me. Always has been. Yeah, just it's sort of as well, because I'm really interested in like vintage clothes. That's sort of most of my shopping, if I'm honest, from vintage shops. So it's just sort of anything that's sort of a mixture of different eras. It's not one specific era that sort of I like the most. It's just, tying them all in together to create something fabulous.
Exactly. Yeah, Schiaparelli's like, you know, fashion is very, very, like how you said, bold. Also has like different accents. I like the accents of like metal, like, you know, the gold and the silver. I love the shoes that have like the gold feet.
And the handbags that have like a face on them. It's my goal one day to own one of those, but I've got a few years probably until that's realistic. But great stuff.
Yeah, right, exactly. I love like, you know, Alexander McQueen and Schiaparelli, you know, because, you know, he pushed the creativity, especially when Alexander McQueen was alive. Like, he pushed the creativity. He was a costume designer. He went to Central St. Martin's and, you know, he really elevated fashion to its higher heights. Another fashion designer is Iris van Herpen, you know. Iris van Herpen is like an amazing like designer, you know, same thing with like Jacquemus or Rodarte. You know, you also look at, I recently looked at this one designer, his name is Kevin Germanier, and he does like these very cool, like, you know, fur, colorful fur couture pieces.
I'm writing that down just really quickly because I need to check it out. Like I take a lot of inspiration. I never copy pieces from ever. Every piece I do, but it's just inspiration. But you had me at colored fur. I was like, I've got to look this guy up. Yeah.
So like colored, like faux fur, and like, you know, it. Like, I love how he plays with like recycled materials and makes it into a beautiful garment. So that's really, really cool about that too. You know, also like how you said Balmain. You know, Victor and Rolf is another, you know, the guys that Victor and Rolf, you know, they do very cool, innovative designs. I love also Mugler. Oh, yeah.
How did I forget that one? Sorry. Like just the whole like cost, like even the leggings, like just, it's just create such an amazing silhouette, like just make anyone look good. You know what I'm saying? Just, yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Exactly. Like with Mugler too, like I love like a lot of his work in the 90s. You know, I think that's one of his most remarkable pieces of fashion, because it was not only innovative, but it was also creative, and he played and pushed the boundaries as well, you know, and like playing with different materials and, you know, different metals. And, you know, so like one of my pieces I really like from Mugler is La Chimere, you know, and it's really cool how he plays with like the metal and the headpiece with the wings. It's really, really amazing. So there's a lot of amazing designers out there. You know what I mean? Is there any new designers possibly that, you know, you ran into that you look up to?
I'm trying to think off the top of my head. Like, in London we have like, it's like a workspace. It's called Never Fade. I don't know if you've heard of it, but I don't actually know if they're still operating, but it's a lot of like small independent designers that go down, and they have like, it sort of coincides with Fashion Week, like these awesome shows, and like you can just go in, like it's not exclusive necessarily. But one of my favorites, she's actually a friend of mine as well, is called Margot. It's Roberta Margot. Mm-hmm. Her work is insane. She's really, really good. And she's very passionate. I think she's quite a new designer, and she's just experimenting with all kinds of, like none of her two designs are the same. She's also very good at understanding like how to team up the right makeup look with each of her individual design. So I'm talking like insane face paint. And I went down there during one of the Fashion Week events, and like, it's quite funny. I was wearing brand new coat and I ended up getting paint like all over it. You just get involved. Like I'll be walking around banging into stuff, and it's really cool. It's just, everyone's very like real, and it's just, you know, people that are up and coming and just passionate and want to be, you know, that all want to be involved. And that's awesome. Really cool. But I think they've moved locations, so you used to just be able to walk into this space. It was in Soho, which is quite a sort of popular area in London to walk in. But I think, I'm not quite sure where they've gone now. This was a few months back. So not this fashion week, but the last one. We've just had it. That's really, really cool place to go to see like new up and coming fashion designers. I mean, there's a lot that goes on here in London. It's so hard to go to every single thing, but like it is, but great. Everything at the palm of your hand if you want to go. Same with you.
Exactly, most definitely. But I also want to get into, just in regards to like fashion illustrators, is there any like fashion illustrators that, you know, have inspired you in terms of like, you know, the way that they draw, the way that they sketch, or any like contemporary artists possibly?
So in terms of like fashion illustrators, there's one I followed for quite a long time called Megan Hess. I don't know if you know her. She's Australian, and she's she does these kind of glamorous, like it's like cups and like plates. Like she works onto like a lot of textiles and that. But she starts. So she did the initial cover for the Sex and the City, the book. So she's she's that first artist. So she's probably the first person, if I'm honest, that got me into like understanding that sort of fashion illustration is something you can make of yourself. Because I was sort of just doing it for a hobby, and I was like, what is this going to lead to, you know? But just every time I saw something, I just had to draw it, and that's kind of where it stemmed from. So she's kind of the first one. Thinking in terms of others, I mean, I honestly follow a lot of different artists for like different reasons. I'm a fashion illustrator, like, but I mean, I should be throwing out lots of names right now, but I'm trying to think who else. I mean, there's loads and loads. Oh God, sorry, I've had like a mind blank as to who else. Another one is Hayden Williams.
Mm-hmm. Hayden Williams.
You know him? Yeah, so he's sort of one of the first, sort of when I first got into Instagram, gosh, like 10 years ago now, he was sort of the biggest illustrator on there back then. And I just watched him over the years, like absolutely grow. And another one is Jamie Lee Redden. Do you know her, who works very, very similar to like Tim Burton? Mm. But it's like long sketches. It's a mixture of fashion and other elements of illustration, but largely fashion. And it's just so simple, but so elegant. It almost looks like she just does it with one stroke, if that makes sense. But mm-hmm. Yeah. There's so many different kinds of people that inspire me to do what I do. Yeah.
Yeah. That's really, really cool because, like, yeah, I followed, you know, Hayden Williams and seeing what he does. Like, he's a great fashion illustrator. I love how he just draws like the body and the outfits and stuff like that. And especially like, I like how he gets inspired by different celebrities, especially like totally. You know, certain events.
Or Rex
like,
dolls, you know, like everything.
Yeah. Like Beyonce, you know, like different female celebrities. So it's really cool to kind of, to see him and especially see him flourish, you know, and get a lot of recognition being a fashion illustrator. You know what I mean? So, but I definitely want to go and ask, in regards to fashion illustration from a woman's perspective, what goes into fashion, you know, illustration, especially like how you see fashion, like, you know, on a woman?
Yeah. So just trying to think. So recircling back, is that you sort of asked me what inspires me to draw, to create what I do, or just.
What inspires you to create what you do?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, I take my inspiration from, it's never just necessarily off the catwalks. It could be like someone on the tube that looks like amazing. And it's just, it's all like sort of embellished, and what they're wearing portrays confidence and freedom. To me, it's expressing to me that they're free in what they're wearing. They feel free. And it just gives them kind of like confidence and like feeling of empowerment. I don't know if that makes sense, but that's always sort of how I've seen it. Mm-hmm. Like just people that just get out there, they wear what they feel, you know, you can sort of
you can see
all that. It's all determined. Yeah. I think that that's largely sort of what's inspired me. So yeah, like I said, it's not always just off the catwalk. It can be people just in everyday walks of life. Like it's people in the supermarket even. Like, I went recently to Berlin. It's just people you see just out and about, like, wow, they just have no fear. They just get it. Yeah. Yeah, women and men, to be honest, but yeah.
Yeah, right, exactly. And the reason why I asked that question, because I feel like there's like differences of how like men and women, you know, do fashion, you know, from a man's standpoint, you know, it's like the high heel, you know, like showing like leg or like having something that's over the top, you know, with a woman, you know, with us as women, it's not that much. You know what I mean? So, you know, like, that's like when you look at cars, like when you look at a car and how it's made, like if like a Mercedes or like a Bentley or, you know, especially like a Mercedes or like a BMW, it's like just angles, you know, it's very masculine, you know?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. So it's like with Mercedes, of course, they do have some of their cars that have very soft curves, you know? There's two totally different perspectives, you know what I mean? Just in regards to drawing and, you know, especially different industries.
Yeah, no, I know what you're saying about that actually with the Mercedes, because you've got like those sort of more sharper, like almost like the older models from like the earlier days when you've got the more, like today's sort of like, you know, convertible-y, more feminine kind of, yeah, that makes sense, yeah. Mm-hmm. I like that.
Yeah, right, exactly. Now, what are some like your favorite, like, you know, art mediums or like any, you know, techniques in particular that you use in regards to your fashion illustrations?
Well, yeah, so I have only, okay, I'll start from the start. So I love drawing with ink, like a fine ink pen onto paper or with a Posca pen onto a canvas. So I do not paint. I like to work with a fine tip. So it is, it's largely, so that's like to me what I call like real life drawing, and you're just taking a risk. You can't go back, re-edit what you've done. You just got to roll with it. And like, I don't always get it right. But I've got a really good way of manipulating any drawing I do. Like, say, for example, I'm left-handed, right? I smudge if I'm doing, it's a very easy thing. I don't know if you're left or right-handed, but when I'm drawing, it's very easy to sort of, anyway.
So,
if you're working on a tablet, you can obviously go back and erase it. But that's the fun part of doing, like, IRL art on a canvas is just got to improvise, like, uh-oh, I've made this error, but you can just draw over. I don't know, I've always, I like the risk that comes with drawing in that sort of net medium. I have, however, just got into digital illustration as well. So, like, a lot of my NFTs that I've currently got out there are a combination of both, obviously digital art. Yeah, digital artwork to me doesn't take as long to do, but it's, yeah, and you can go back and like sort of erase bits and pieces. But I mean, I still love that too, because you have a very easy, it's all at the palm of your fingertips to play with color. Both are great. But yeah, I think overall, definitely favorite medium is hand drawing. Yeah, always has been. I think it's because I know it better. Yeah. Still learning though with digital. I want to get more into doing like, I still got to keep growing with my Procreate skills, but I mean, it's very easy to pick up. Yeah.
Right, exactly. What I like about your work is very it's not only like a fashion illustration, but I like how the figures are very fun, and you know, your body is very expressive, you know, so it's not like, you know, it's not literal on anatomy, you know, but I like how, you know, what you do with the fashion illustrations, it's very playful, you know, it's very loose, you know, so like, is that, has that always been like your intention in regards to having, you know, your illustrations very loose and very fun, very whimsical?
Definitely. Yeah, like I like to bring, you know, like happiness with my work usually. Like, I mean, some of my other black and white pieces explore different things. Like, you, like these are the sort of larger canvas pieces that I do. But definitely with my kind of fashion illustration style, it is always fun and fabulous and flaunt-worthy is what I like to say. Yeah. So that, yeah, you hit the nail on the head with that. Yeah, playful. It's a good one.
Yeah. That's really, really cool. But I definitely want to also get into NFTs and Web3. So how did you get into NFTs? Like, who first exposed you, or what first exposed you to NFTs?
Yeah. So I had never even heard of NFTs. I had no idea. Like, I had no idea about, like, you know, what even Web3 meant, like just nothing. I had no idea how to even use crypto, how to set up a wallet, anything like that. It was like, so my partner has a really good friend. My partner's into gaming. So he's got a friend through gaming that he knows. And this guy's actually, I didn't know this, but he's actually quite a big collector in the space. So he's very much in the know of, like, you know, this was back in about June last year when we had a call. I had a call with him because he said, you should be looking at this, is exploring this as an option, because, you know, it's a really good way to get your work out there. And I was kind of like, it took me, if I'm honest, probably a couple of months after that to get set up fully. So like, I started working on a collection. My first collection was only 10 pieces, and it was called IRL Girls. So not LFG Girls, but IRL, like in real life. Similar thing, but every girl has kind of a message written on her outfit. So anyway, so that took a while to sort of get together. And then I had to sort of work out how to like market it and all that. So yeah, he did help me, and it was just him in the space. He sort of told me, you know, he gave me good advice on like the best kind of artist to connect with, who's sort of real in the space, and like, you know, and it really did help me. And he just was very, very much encouraging that it's very important to have a presence on Twitter, which I did not really use either. I think my account hadn't been open since like 2008 or something. So like, I'm all over it now. It's my favorite platform out there. So yeah, that's sort of it. I mean, just, you know, through that introduction, I was away really. It really helped, yeah. And he collected a couple of my pieces when I first launched, so it looked good.
Yeah. That's really, really cool. Because, like, for me, like, because I actually heard about NFTs last year, but I didn't really pay too much about it, you know, until this year, like within like March or April, when people were talking about it on Clubhouse. So that's how I learned more about NFTs, and I got interested in knowing more about it. And of course, I'm still learning a lot more about it before I jump into the space. Because it is something that I would like to do, is have my own NFT collection and things like that, you know. So yeah, but it's a very interesting, you know, space, and you can connect with people, and there's people that are willing to help you. So that's very, very cool.
Totally. No, it's amazing. That was the best thing I noticed about it, is that everyone, I mean, I'm going to be honest, like probably about 80% of people on that space are real, genuine. Everyone wants to help and uplift each other. Like it is a really positive place to be. Like, you get the odd people that are just, they dip in and dip out, like they're not really there for the long run, but you work out who those people are pretty quickly. But yeah, I'd say like 80% of the time it is like the best. I just want to keep creating, and that's the best thing. Like, people are there to drive you, encourage you, and like, you know, it's really, really good. I'm really glad that I came across it. Well, I mean, yeah, with Twitter, but yeah.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Most definitely. But I definitely want to, you know, ask you about this quote that you have within your website, because I think it's very, very interesting. So you describe your work as a scream of rebellion from women who want to affiliate themselves with their needs, desires, and dreams. Yes. So what does that mean to you? And like, why is that very important to you?
So rebellion to me is like being able to wear, you know, you're not sort of presenting yourself as into how the norm expects you to be. You are doing whatever you want. And that is kind of like, you know, that could mean wearing like, I'm just going to say it, like a harness or something, and just not caring, like something that's a bit kind of like androgynous. Like,
right.
I mean, some of my work does kind of have like a BDSM feel to it, but on a very light level. It's not super, super hardcore. But I think that kind of explores it too. It's just being whoever you want to be and feeling, you know, that without feeling restricted. And So I think, yeah, that's sort of a large part. And just, yeah, that comes across to me as being rebellious in a way, because you're not going, you're going against the expectation, against the norm. You're having fun. You're putting your best foot forward and you're being fearless. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, right. Most definitely. Now tell us more about LFG Girls, the NFT collection. Now, like, tell us about the collection, but not only that, but like, how many, you know, illustrations do you plan to really have within the NFT collection? You know, do you plan on having like utility involved within your collection? Like, tell us about that.
I will. No, with pleasure. I'd love to talk about this one. So I'm sort of about halfway through the artwork. If I'm honest, it's taken me a very long time because I want to get, so every single piece in the collection, which I should have said to start with, is 100 pieces. So it's a 100 piece collection. Every single woman is drawn individually. So she's not from like what you see of all these PFP, like 10,000 piece NFT projects, is that they're kind of done with layers. So it's really easy to generate like 100 versions. You know what I'm saying? Like, so you have like 20 hairstyles and it's just, but no, not. So I wanted to make this collection very unique and very much more of a collection. So like, I don't necessarily want to call it an NFT collection. What I'm trying to do here is not break up the digital from the physical world. So with the utility side of it comes each collector would also get a high resolution massive print of their selected LFG girl. So that's, everyone gets a big print of it. So they've got sort of physical and they own the NFT. So that's kind of what I'm looking at doing now. I will say, yes, about halfway through the artwork, I am also in production of making a video so I can really explain exactly more about it in more depth before it gets released. I really want to talk about it more because I think I may have gone in a bit red hot with launching it on Twitter as early as I did. But I am, I think it's kind of a good idea too, though, because like people like yourself, you know, everyone's curious about it. So it's not always a bad thing. But I think, yeah, I just want to talk about it more. I've got, make a video about it and just have a bit more of a story behind exactly what the collection is. Another thing too, so like there's a charity here in the UK, they're UK based, called Smartworks Charity. They are amazing. I don't know if you've heard of them or if they're in the States. They probably have similar ones, but just with a different name.
Right.
So these charities are fantastic. So they help women for any different reason that have been out of employment. So it could be like, you know, for example, they've just maybe separated from their husband, they need to go back to work. They've been on maternity leave, they've got to go back to work. Just reasons they've got to go back to work, like many different. This specific charity will help. So a lot of people donate clothing to this charity. This charity have stylists and they have coaches, like lifestyle coaches, that help these women, train them to feel empowered to go back and to go back into the workforce. It's really cool. They take them on like a consultation. They take them through this warehouse of clothing. Mm-hmm. They really coach them, talk to them. It takes a few, I think, sessions until they're ready to go. But that to me is like so, so cool. And I'm going to, so the quarter of my earnings from that collection will go to this charity because I just want to be, you know, help them out, be a part of it.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah. They're really, really cool people that run it. So I've been to like a couple of their events and like they are really cool. It's really good. Yeah.
Yeah.
My work ties in well with what they're trying to achieve. Like a lot of their clothing that they dress people in, like they have people that work with color. It's all very, it's fun. It's playful. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really, really cool. But what advice would you give for someone, you know, especially a fashion illustrator who wants to get into NFTs, you know, just in regards not only having an NFT collection, but also especially regarding pricing as well?
Yeah, sure. So I would say firstly, with anyone getting in, it's anyone in general to get into NFTs, I would say the most important thing is to have a presence on Twitter before launching anything. Take it from me, because I went in a bit too red hot too quickly. I didn't have much of a following, so I didn't get much of a sort of reception for my first collection. Right. Eventually, though, it did quite well. I'd say a massive thing too is patience. Be patient. You're talking about pricing. So I'd say what I did is I sort of connected with about 20 other artists on like a Twitter, like a chat group. Mm-hmm. Just people that kind of, we're all doing similar kind of like one of one pieces, our work's right. kind of in the same range. And like, that is a really good way to talk to people about pricing. You don't want to, like, I don't want to say the word like leverage yourself off what exactly they're pricing their work as, but it gives you quite a good indication. Right. So like, yeah, I mean, yeah, that did really help me. So like that, I think that was some really good advice that I was given that I follow, just to understand I'm not going way too out of the ballpark here, right. or I'm going way under that. Yeah, that really has helped me.
Mm. So, yeah, pretty good. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and it's very interesting because, you know, it can be hard just in regards to pricing what you're worth. You know what I mean? Especially like any artworks, you know, even if it's NFTs. And, you know, I've always, you know, said, like, with other people that I've interviewed, you know, you don't want to price too low. You don't want to price too high. And even that's something that I still, you know, work on, you know, especially being not only an illustrator and an all-around artist, but also a nail artist in the beauty industry. So, you know, yeah. It is something that it can be difficult to kind of weigh in on that.
Totally, totally. So I say, like, so my first collection, I did 10 pieces. I think I was talking about it before. That was called the IRL Gals. That was 10 pieces. And I priced them at a very, like, just, it wasn't like a super low ball price, but it was just a good price to like measure if people wanting to pay for that too. So it was 0.05 Ethereum. And that, I think, was a good ballpark figure. And then since then, I've been able to go up, or I've done additions where it's slightly cheaper. It's just your understanding. And it's really just about connecting and asking questions, because people are super honest with you. They'll always respond to you. And yeah, I think that's why I think it's just such a good space, Twitter, for that reason. And Discord as well is right. The other one. I don't massively use Discord. I need to, though. It's my goal, especially with LFG girls. So yeah, that's something I need to sort of get my head around a bit more. But for now, it's just, yeah, Twitter's where it's at.
Mm. Yeah, right, most definitely. But I definitely want to also get into as well with NFTs. Do you feel like, you know, NFTs and like the realm of Web3 is here to stay, or do you feel like it'll just fade over time? Like, what's your take on that?
So if I'm honest, like, I mean, so last year was kind of like a bit of a boom, like around this time until January. So yeah, November to January, it was like, wow, everyone was like getting on it. Like, heck yeah, we can make tons of money, do this, do that. Those people have kind of gone now. A lot of people are still saying, like, you know, NFTs are here to stay and all this. And like, yeah, I do agree. I don't think it's quite the beginning. People say, oh, it's only the beginning. I don't quite necessarily believe that, because it's not really the beginning. But I think as time is going by, more and more people are starting to understand it and want to be a part of it. So, yeah, I think here to stay. Yeah, because I don't necessarily know if, like, I feel like there's more opportunity with NFTs in terms of different, like, how do I say it? Like, other avenues without just being art. Like, there's other ways.
Yeah, other industries, yeah.
Yeah, other industries. And I think that will also, that's still something that's yet to happen.
Right.
I think that could also be very big too. So I definitely, yeah, I would say keep at it, like, to anyone, don't stop. Yeah. Mm.
Yeah, yeah, right, most definitely. You know, and the thing is that it is pretty new. Like, am I too late? Is this, you know, I know everybody is like, you know, already got some NFT collections. You know, I'm seeing, like, you know, World of Women, you know, Bored Ape, you know, like, wow, like, everybody, like, you know, they've been on it longer than me. But it's like, you know, but really, if you think about it, NFTs, the realm of Web3 is still brand new. You know, it isn't like, you know, 10, 15, 20 years of it being here.
No. Yeah, definitely.
So that's the thing. But yeah, but most definitely, I do agree. And you have a point, because it does take time for other industries to adapt to it. You know, definitely. So there are certain brands, from what I've heard, in the beauty industry, taking advantage of NFT, especially the car industry. Like, you know, one of the car brands, specifically Bentley, you know, is taking advantage or trying to get into NFTs. And I think a few other car brands, I believe. But yeah, so it's slowly getting there, you know.
Yeah, I think so. No, I think so. But you know, it's funny thing that I sort of said that it feels like it's like we're not that new. It's because honestly, every day in the NFT community feels like 2 weeks. It's like a roller coaster. Like, seriously, yeah. There's like high highs. No, I wouldn't say there's low lows, but there's just days where things are a bit stagnant. But then when you're like up, like for example, with me, I'm just so excited whenever I drop like a new collection. To me, it's not always about selling work. It's more about like sharing works in progress and just having like meaningful conversations with other artists. Yeah, so I think That hasn't died anyway. Yeah, that's still very much there.
Exactly. Now, what are some things that you find that are missing in Web3, or what are some things that you would like to see more of in Web3?
So, I mean, I heard of this stat recently. Apparently, women only make up about 13% so far of the NFT space. 13.
Mm. Wow.
So obviously, I want to see more women like sort of led projects. I mean, they are out there. Like obviously, World of Women. There's another one called Woman Tribe. Like they're fantastic. But I just think, I want to see more of like sort of people and women like just being educated on how to get into Web3, how to not be intimidated and just how to go for it. Because sometimes you can go into like, so that's another thing too, is just, sorry, I'm recircling back to an earlier question you asked me, but like with being able to talk about yourself and get yourself out there, like a large portion of that is done through Twitter spaces. So like it's going on and like introducing yourself. And like I've spoken on quite a lot of those now, and like not all of them are the right ones. You need to do your research and know I've gone on and just introduced myself, and it's just like quiet. Like no one really is grasping what you've got to say. I just think, it's about sort of knowing your crowd before going in, if that makes sense. I think like everyone's friendly, but some spaces are more suitable for you than others. And I think, sometimes it has made me get a bit like, not always that keen to go on spaces all the time. There's a lot of fantastic as well as silent spaces. So you can go onto them and share your work. A lot of people don't like to speak, on a space. I don't really mind myself, but there's options for everyone.
Most definitely. You have to be selective what spaces you jump into.
Some of it's like everyone agrees with the host. It's like, and like they don't let you up to speak. It's just like, it's more like a conversation between like five people, whereas there's an audience of like 200 and people aren't really, it's just, I don't know, people are just talking about random stuff and it just seems a bit like, okay, what's happening here? I don't know, that's just my opinion sometimes.
But some
of them are fantastic. Like, I mean, if I can share a couple that I think are amazing on here, like there's one called Amplify Woman and they have those twice a week, and that is the best space. And I've spoken on that a couple of times, and it's hosted by two women and they just let everyone come up and talk about their project, and it's just super fun. They always have like a question that's just like meant to like, it's just really funny. Like, would you rather have like, toes for eyes or eyes for toes? Like that kind of thing. And like, you have to answer it at the end of like speaking. It keeps everyone engaged. That's a really good space. Yeah. I mean, there's a few more as well, but that's the first one that stands out to me.
Most definitely. And I like how some of the Twitter spaces, especially the ones I've been in person, it's been very engaging, very respectful, very, very kind, So I'm very grateful to be a part of those spaces, because I'm not in the NFT space yet, but the cool thing is I won my first NFT, which is pretty cool, because one of the Twitter spaces was hosted by Layback Llamas and Global Kind NFT. And GlobalKind did a giveaway for one of their NFTs. And I was like, wow, like, I want an NFT, because it was like this whole thing where you speak, and you give like a piece of advice. It was like, me and four other people. And it was like, Asia the Bird, you won. I was like, yes.
Great spaces. Yeah, definitely. And it's like a conversation. You're just sharing something. That sounds awesome. I love those. Like when these giveaways as well. And everyone's excited, like,
Yeah. I was like, yes.
Yeah.
But it was like, it gave me like a full, like, gave me more of a bit of an introduction to NFTs, especially like the base of how like, wallet works and how to connect your wallet, especially the OpenSea and stuff like that. So, And like I said, I'm still learning about the space. So I don't know like, everything about it, but I'm still like learning, as I go.
Yeah, you're going to be able to do some fantastic things, I'm sure. You can talk about that. Like, I'm sure I'll hear more about it, like with nail design and stuff, if you wanted to do like a collection like that. That's the thing, is that there's absolutely no limits in the space. Like there's a woman that, her name's Rifka's Cakes, and she does, like she's had massive success, and she bakes cakes and she like models them and she sells them as NFTs as well. Like cake kind of,
Wow.
And they're amazing. Okay. She's really well. Yeah. I recommend checking her out. Rifka's Cakes. Yeah. But just, every idea is worth exploring. That's it. No limits.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Most definitely. Yeah. But I definitely want to also, you know, get into as well, like, you know, what's next for LFG Girls? Like, is there any plans down the line in the next couple years in regards to where you see your collection? Like, you know, what's next for you possibly?
So, I mean, once I've got my first collection off the ground, and it will be happening, I promise you all, it's just taking a bit more time. I want to keep going. So like in 100-piece collection. So just keep going forward. And like, I'm not sure if I'll stay with working with the same charity or I'll go elsewhere. But what I want to have is just, they're just collector's items that people can just collect. And I think, I don't fully know yet exactly what the future holds, but I do just want to keep releasing them in like 100. And like, you know, as you go, things change. You know, you grow things, you know, it might not be what I'm planning now. I noticed that, like, no plan I put in place ever quite works out how I,
right,
you know, plan for it to be, but it, you know, it can be better, you know. But I think I just, as long as I stick to originality and doing it how I'm doing it, just one piece that's no two pieces the same, I think we'll be in quite a good place. So yeah, I think it's just seeing how the first collection goes and sort of measuring it from there. But I absolutely, like, LFG Girls are here to stay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Last but not least, where could people find you on social media and how could people support your work and your NFTs?
Yeah, sure. So I have my personal Twitter. So I've got a Twitter account for LFG Girls, but I have another one, which is my personal Twitter called ELinesIRL. On that account is a link to everything. So I've got like a website, Instagram. I've just started actually getting into TikTok. I still need to get a bit better at learning how to work it, but I'm doing like more like live work. People can see my process. So, I mean, on my link tree is sort of everything there. Another thing I will say as well is this is all on my personal Twitter account, ELinesIRL. When I say personal, like, it's not my LFG Girls. So I have also just released a new collection a week ago on there as well, which is just a 6-piece collection. It's all very like bold, timeless, classic fashion illustrations. They're all digitally drawn and they've got a bright red background. They're just black and white on red. And like, yeah, I just say like, that's the most recent work I've done. Like, be sure to check it out and I will keep going with LFG Girls. It's what I'm working on now. And yeah, just got to get busting really. But yeah, all over it.
Yeah, that's really, really cool. Well, thank you so much, Emma, for jumping onto the show. Your work is absolutely great. I really enjoyed this conversation. This was very, like, fun. And, you know, it was really cool to meet you and get to know your work. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Take care.
Yes, bye.
Bye-bye. Hello, everyone. Thank you all so much for watching. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe to the channel. Be sure to click the bell for notifications. Also, follow me on my social media platforms and visit my website, theasiaticbird.com, and be on the lookout for more interviews involving Web3, NFTs, crypto, and the metaverse.